Church. Thank you, Trick. Love was born. Those are great words, great lyrics. Amen. Love is born. Thank you. Well, welcome, everybody. Welcome those online. Great to have everybody this morning. Sounds like you guys had a wonderful time on Friday night. My brother didn't save me any cookies. Ken, you didn't save me any either, I guess. But praise God. Sounds like it was a wonderful time. I pray you'll continue to enjoy the balance of the month, right? Not just the day we just celebrate the birth of Christ and continue to celebrate that and just enjoy his goodness. Amen. So this morning, our title of our message is The Greatest Song. The Greatest Song. And you may have given that some thought already. And even as I'm speaking now, there might be a song popping into your head right now that you consider to be the greatest song. Right? We all have, you know, songs that we are familiar with. Maybe it's a gospel song, you know, probably hard to rule out Amazing Grace or How Great Thou Art or, you know, Rock of Ages, you know. There's just so many. But maybe there's some others, you know. I thought of some as I was thinking about the message. I was actually in New York last year, and my son and I got to go to the Garden and hear Billy Joel, which is one of my favorite artists, you know, he's got a lot of unbelievable hits. And if you've ever gone to a concert or a, you know, one of your favorite artists, what was cool is, you know, many of us know the song Piano Man, which he did. He usually closes out. Well, he goes dead silent, you know, about midway through, and you just hear 17,000 people singing Piano Man, right? Like, even now as I say it, you probably know a few of the lyrics to it. And it is arguably one of the greatest songs. But for me, I think when we talk about the greatest song, two things. Number one, it can't be a great song if you don't know the words to it. Right? Like, it's a great song to me because I know the words to it. Like, if you're sitting there like, oh, that's nice, they know the words, and you can't join in, you're going to miss something, right? So you do have to know the words. And then second, and probably most important, and Trick, you'll appreciate this, you do actually have to sing it. Just knowing the words ain't good enough, church. You got to sing it. And of course, we're going to talk about that in the context of God and the Spirit of God and what that means. And the Bible talks often about singing, speaks often of songs. And of course, I believe the greatest song that anybody could ever sing, whether now or ever or in the world, it's the song of salvation. It is the song of salvation. And there are many verses that talk about the song of salvation. When they left in Egypt and they crossed the Red Sea, the first thing they did when they get over there, the song of Moses, that was the song of salvation. Song, and there are many songs written about that, right? The horse and rider thrown into the sea. The Lord is God and I will praise him. So the horse and the rider were thrown in the sea. It is the song of salvation. How do you know you're saved? Your horse and the rider die. The horse and the rider. The rider, you're the rider, by the way. Talking about a lifestyle, talking about basically the absence of God, the absence of faith. That has to die. That is salvation. There's salvation, the salvation of the Lord. And David actually also said this in one of his Psalms. He said, deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation, and I will sing aloud of thy righteousness. Now again, to sing aloud, it means you can hear what David is singing about. What was he singing about? Well, he asked for deliverance from blood guiltiness. Means, what does that mean? Well, church, it just means he's not finding people guilty. If you're finding people guilty, that is the blood. Isaiah also talks about that when they're going to talk to God. He's like, I can't hear you. You got blood on your hands. Why do you got blood on your hands? Because you're talking smack and trashing people and calling them sinners and saying they're rotten, telling them they're going to hell, and you're condemning them. You've got blood on your hands. God says, huh? I can't hear you. Go wash your hands. It'd be like going to the dinner table when you were playing and, you know, your mom, what? Get in the bathroom and wash them hands before you sit down at this dinner table. Amen. That's what God does. You're going to talk to me? No. Go wash your hands. Amen. So in order for me to sing righteousness, I can't call you a sinner and talk about your sin. That's being blood guilty. God, you got to deliver me from that mentality. You got to deliver me from that mindset. And what? Well, sing their praises instead. Now, again, the world says that's crazy, that's foolish, and that don't make sense. Because the minute we see somebody do something wrong, what do we got to do? We got to talk about their guiltiness. Right, but the Word of God says something completely different. It says that if you're going to sing about salvation, if you're going to sing the greatest song ever sung, you've got to sing their praises, and you can't do that. That's not salvation. It's actually the opposite of salvation. Isaiah also says that, I create the fruit of your lips, peace, peace, to those that are far and to those that are near, says the Lord, I will heal him. You should speak peace to those that are close, which we do. The family we love, hey, it's peace, hey, it's beautiful. But what about those that are far? What about those that have been cast off? What about those that we have spoken, you know, disparaging words about? Will you still offer peace, or are we still going to keep them at arm's length and reject them? That's not peace. God didn't create that. The fruit of your lips, it is peace. What do you think they were eating in the Garden of Eden? It wasn't a piece of fruit. Church, it was the thoughts that we then speak. That is the fruit we're partaking of. Are you partaking of sin and blood guiltiness, or are you partaking of the fruit of peace? Church, we got it backwards, man. We just got it backwards. Like, I thought Calvary took care of sin once and for all. I thought the words on the cross was, it is finished. No, let's go around and talk about it and tell everybody about their sin, and this one did this, and this one did that. And No, the words on the cross were, it is finished. It is finished. Amen. Why are we still talking about it? And then we want to go around praising the Lord and singing salvation songs. And did you hear about Sally? Did you hear about Phil? Your song is messed up, man. Ain't nobody singing that song. God sure ain't singing that song. And that is not the song of salvation. That's not the song of salvation. David also spoke of another song. I want to actually read that one for you. It's in 144, I believe. And all of the Psalms are songs. They're all songs. And church, if we're not singing, by the way, it's our life song, okay? It's not like a moment on Sunday, church. Matter of fact, he'll trade you your moment on Sunday for the balance of the week. Anybody willing to make that trade? What's your life song look like Monday through Saturday, church? That's what he's more interested in. I mean, he'll take the hour here, but he's looking for the life song, man, not the moment on Sunday. Psalm 144, verse 9. I will sing a new song unto thee, O God, upon the psaltery and upon the instrument of 10 strings, will I sing praises unto thee. It is he that giveth salvation unto kings, who delivereth David his servant from the hurtful sword. What was the hurtful sword? It was David's mouth. What did it supposed to? It was supposed to deliver salvation to the kings. And how did he do that? With the 10-stringed instrument. That was it, a new song. I think God wants to hear some new music. Yeah. Like, it's like you got your playlist, and it's like, oh, this is good, but, man, I need a new song, man. You ever want a new song, like something like, you know, I need a little more pep, you know. Like, at the end of your workout, it's like, man, I need a better song. I'm not going to get through the workout. I need a song to get me jacked up and ready to go. Amen. No, I'm just the only one. You guys are... Is there any music in your house at all? As you guys know, I'm pretty fond of music. And who's the creator of music? The world wants to take... God created music, man. God, it's all God's. God created music. And it's okay if you have some secular favorites. I do, church. Listen, at the end, when I'm doing my cardio and I got like 5 minutes left and I want to just get off... I put on Van Halen's Jump. Oh, yeah. Or I put on U2's Streets Have No Name. Oh, yeah. I got to finish this. Give me a better song. We just need a better song, man. It's a new song. What is this 10-stringed instrument? It's us. It's humanity. The 10 is representative of humanity. There were 10 lepers. They all got healed. There were 10 virgins. There were 10 servants. 10, it's speaking of us. It's the tithe. It's the 10th. It's the Christ that's inside of humanity that has a song that has yet to been singing, that we haven't yet quite sung yet. We are the 10-stringed instrument. You should produce a sound. Now listen, church, I need 10 strings, not one. If Trick was up there with a guitar with just one string, I'm going to sound rough. It's the corporate. It's your song and my song and his song and her song. It's the collective song, church. You need 10 strings, not one. But it is the song of salvation. Revelations, I think it's Revelations 14, talks about the Lamb song. When you read through that, what does it say? It says no man can learn that song except those that have been redeemed from the earth. Amen. If the earth is going to influence you and tell you what to do and how to do it and when to sing and when to dance, you haven't been delivered yet. You've got to be delivered from that. You can't learn it. What can you do? You can live it. You got a song to live. I got a song to live. We all have a song to live. And how beautiful is that? Like, God's not just looking for us to just grind out a Sunday and listen to a message and, you know, pray. All of that's important. But can you put a little pep in your step? Can you have a little song in your heart? Can you declare the goodness of God? Can your life be a song? Amen. I mean, is God that good? Is he that big?
Yes.
I mean, I think he is. I think he is. Let's take a look at Psalm 46. This is also a very well-known psalm. Very powerful psalm. I think my brother has a beautiful picture in his house with one of the verses in here. But Psalm 46, it says, our refuge and our strength. To the chief musician for the sons of Korah, a song upon Alamoth. Now, who are the sons of Korah? That there's relevance there. You just can't blow by it. No, there's relevance there. Korah will remember. They were the priests in the church. When Moses and Aaron, they anointed Korah and his family, they were supposed to take care of the sanctuary. You know what else they were supposed to do in that sanctuary? They were supposed to sing the glory of God. Whether you were in it or not, they were just supposed to sing the glory of God. They kept the sanctuary and they kept the song going. Now, when they anointed Korah, what happened? Korah, he didn't have a new song. He just kept hitting repeat and repeat and repeat. This is just me paraphrasing here. And then he's like, is this it? And what do you have? He started to complain. And Bible says that he resented Moses. Who put you in charge? You get in here, you set up the church. I'm gonna preach a message. Yeah, but that's not your job and that's not what you were anointed to do, and God actually told you to take care of the house and to sing in it. But he had resentment. And then he started doing what? He started, hey, let me tell you, this guy ain't what he thinks he is, and he started talking to everybody, all the congregation. And you know what? There's some folks that said, yeah, he's got a point. Yeah, they always got a point, church. And then finally they confronted Moses with it. Uh-huh. Korah confronts him and says, hey, I don't know who you think you are. And Moses says, you might want to tread lightly, my friend. And he actually prayed for Korah. He's like, oh, Lord, what happened here? Give him a new iPod or something. He's and he complained and he complained and complained. And then he brought it forth and, you know, they were going to light the censer. And if God spoke and wanted Korah, then that was going to be the declaration. Never mind the censer. You guys know the story. What happened? It says the earth opened up and swallowed him. It swallowed him. Not only did it swallow him, but all those that said, well, you know, he's got a point. Yeah, good, we're taking you too. Swallow them. I think it was Dothan and Abitham. I can't remember the second one, but swallowed them up too. Whoops. And again, the church is a picture. Because the truth is, if you let resentment creep into your life, it will consume you. It'll just swallow you up. You'll have no life. You'll have no song.
resentment is just it slowly, you know, kind of trickles in, and then it builds and it builds. Like, I don't think he woke up one morning and said, "I think I'm going to take on Moses." I don't think that's how it happened. I think he might have been, "Oh man, vacuum cleaner ain't working so good. I got to vacuum the sanctuary. Can't, oh, this lighter ain't working. I got to light the candle." Like, it just builds, and all of a sudden it's resentment. It's resentment. Why? Well, you should have stayed focused on the song. You should have stayed focused on the song, but you didn't. Instead, you had resentment. And the truth is, resentment will eat you alive from the inside out, man. You won't have any life, and I promise you, you won't have a song anyone's going to want to sing. You won't, because it just bleeds over. It just bleeds over everywhere. It just bleeds. And that's the picture. That's what he's telling you. Don't let that be. But here's the beautiful thing, if you can see this morning. So now fast forward. Korah's still in charge. They were from the tribe of Levi. They're still priests. Now they're singing, if you can see the redemption here. And he's saying what? The song of Alamoth. That Alamoth, it's talking about the young bride singing her wedding song. Now, I don't know if any of you, you know, have ever gotten married, but, you know, your first dance, you know, when you dance with your, you know, your spouse, right? It's like, oh, we got to pick the perfect song. Why? To show and declare our love for one another. We want the world to know, right? You know, back in the 80s, it was always and forever, each moment with you. Thank you, Reb. I don't know what it is today, but I'm old school. But that's what he's talking about. The sons of Korah, they're now singing. They're singing this love song. They're singing this wedding song. So we went from, hey, you stink, to, no, man, God's restored. Again, it's always a restoration plan, man. But anyway, that is just so beautiful here. But it says what? God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. A very present help in trouble. Don't worry about your troubles yesterday. I'm talking about today. What are you facing today? He's very present. He's in the here and the now. And sometimes we don't believe that, because when the trouble shows up, we don't think he's present. Because that's somehow, you know, when you read like stories of Job, well, God was riding that whole thing with him the whole time. His three friends say, well, you must have done something, right? And God is not near you. No, that's a lie. That's not true. That's not true. You can the absence of God can never be in your life. And when those feelings rise up inside of you and say, God is not with me, or God is distant, or God, where are you? They are a lie. Amen. And the truth is, when we listen to those lies, we don't feel God's presence, and we usually wind up in dark places. I do. It's a lie. Amen. It's not true. He is your very present help in time of trouble. Amen. And that word trouble, it means adversity. When toughness hits you, and it will hit you, church, it hits all of us. It's God's design. But what he says is what? I'm with you. I am with you always. Therefore, listen, if this is the greatest, one of the greatest therefores. You got adversity? Therefore. Will not we fear? Though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. When some stuff gets shaken up in your life, be it the removal of your earth or the removal of a mountain, do not fear. Say, therefore. Why? Because he is very present. He just told you he's very present. And then he tells you chaos is just coming on the scene. But he didn't tell you the chaos is coming first. The first thing he told you was to give you comfort and peace. I'm with you. I'm very present. How present is he? He's a hand breath away. If he got any closer, he'd be biting you. And some of you, he probably is biting you. It's just a love bite. And church, I see this as the things in our life that we felt were foundational to us, that we held on to. And, you know, we had some mountains that we thought, oh, this is a safe place for us. That could be these ideas, that could be religion, that could be relationships, that could be a job, it could be a lot of things. The only reason he's removing it is because it's not really what your foundation is based on. And by the way, at some point in time, you ain't going to sing about it. Amen. So God just removes it. He just removes it from you. Though the waters thereof roar, and be troubled, and though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah.
So again, he's going on and talking about here the waters that roar. Again, it's us that roar.
Because the minute something is removed from my life or something is taken from me that I feel like this injustice in my life, what is the first thing I do? I don't pray, Lord Jesus, thank you, and this is beautiful. No, I roar.
And then what do? Well, then I get swelled all up. Pride.
I believe most times the only reason we're roaring is because it's coming from a place of pride, not a place of humility.
Pride will always roar and say, foul. Pride will always say, that's not fair.
Jesus Christ never spoke the words, that's not fair.
But I say that sometimes. That's not fair. Amen.
First of all, nobody's going to sing that song with me. Because everyone's going to say to me, get over it. Yeah. Praise the Lord, you should.
Amen. And there's no strength in that. Christ is not in that. And it comes from a place of pride.
So all of this that he's doing is, again, it's of course, it's always to change us. For what? So that you will eventually sing the song, church.
God's going to get you to sing one way or another. He's going to get you to sing one way or another. Why? Because he wants his song. Amen. He wants his song. You think he wants you to run around crying and complaining? He wants you to run around with resentment in your heart? You think like that's what God wants? That why he created us? I think he created us so we could sing.
Which means he's probably got to do something to me to change me. He's got to probably remove some things in my life. Right up here is most of the removing. He's got to remove some stupid thinking on my part. Because otherwise I won't sing. Amen?
And he says, Selah. Why is he Selah? Context change. It's a pause. That's actually used in a musical term. It means to pause. You know, like there's usually stanzas within a song. Okay, so we just sang the first stanza. You know, you're taking us somewhere we're just not sure yet. Pause. We're getting ready for a new change here. We're getting ready for a context change. Amen.
Verse 4. There is a river. Man, those are beautiful words right there. Pause. You ready? There is a river. Promise. Hope. Something to look forward to. Something that maybe we can sing about, church. There is a river. There is a river. Yes. The streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High.
Oh, man. Yes. Now we're talking. Maybe he's taking my eyes off of the natural circumstances. Maybe he's taking them off of this adversity. Maybe he's taking them off of the people that are roaring in my life and cussing me and screaming at me and calling me guilty. And he's saying, Phil, let me redirect you to this river. Let me show you this place where you'll actually be glad. You'll actually be happy. Like, if God has the choice for you to be miserable or happy, what choice do you think he's going to make, church? Amen. Well, geez, Pastor, I thought it was miserable. You're in the wrong church. Get out! It doesn't mean we won't go through some stuff. Of course we will. But it's how we go through it that matters. No, the world may not accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. They will definitely have a tougher road to hoe. As though that road's going to be harder with him? Church, the road stinks without him. I've been on it. It's easier with him. We may go through some stuff, but it's easier with him. I can still sing. You can still sing. You got no shot of singing without him.
Except a funeral song, maybe, or I don't know what. There is a river, the holy place. We're talking about the Most High. We're talking about faith. We're talking about God Almighty. When we place all of our confidence and trust is in him, even though he's removing my earth and ripping down my mountains, all of my confidence and trust is in him, not in the earth and the mountains. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
There is a river. What is the river? It's the same thing as the fruit of your lips. Isaiah 66 says there is a river of peace that is flowing. When the Bible talks about a river, he's talking about what is the flow in your life? If you're like me, sometimes you build the Hoover Dam. You ain't getting none.
No one else would ever build the Hoover Dam, right? Just the pastor. Mike's got a Hoover Dam, too. I seen it. It's supposed to be a flow. It's supposed to be a flow that comes out of you. It is a reflection of your lifestyle. And why did he create that? He says so that the Gentiles will come and draw from the waters. The Gentiles, not the Israelites, not the tribes, the Gentiles. Who will you let drink from your river? Who is allowed to drink from your river? Can a Gentile come and drink from your river? Can a sinner come and drink from your river? That's why he created it. Not to take it away from them. Not to wall it up and say, no, not, you ain't getting none.
Great hope.
You're supposed to let them draw down and have some of that.
Amen.
Drink peace from that river. That river that's got to flow out of you, whether they be near or far. Amen. I don't care how you view the people in your life, and they may not accept you today. You say, my river's open. You can drink from it anytime. I love you. And I have nothing but peace to offer you.
Amen.
I don't care what they did to you, church. Because again, that's the earth and the mountain he's got to remove. We're not based in that, right? The heavens do rule. The heavens do rule according to the word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 5. God is in the midst of her. Who her? The river. What do you think is in the middle of your river? When it's flowing with peace, it's God. She shall not be moved. You mean even though things are going on in my life, even though the waters do roar, you shall not be moved.
Uh-huh.
That's faith. That's the power of God. You shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. Help her, the river. You're the river. You're supposed to provide help. When? Right early. Well, how about later? No, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible doesn't say later. If he wanted it to be later, he'd have put instead of they, he would have wrote later. He would have had David, know what? Write later. Let him do that later. He didn't have him write that. He said right early. What does that mean? That word early means the break of dawn. Is it at the beginning of the day or the end of the day? Later. Later. Just me. I'm the only one that's, not now, Lord. Got a lot going on. Later. But I promise it'll be later. Later never comes, church. We will put off forgiveness and peace for now until eternity. I'll catch him on the other side, Lord. Right early. Why is that? Why do we do that? Later. Why isn't it the first thing we do? Why can't the first thing we do when we get up in the morning is sing salvation, is sing peace, is sing joy? Why isn't it the first thing we do? Not the last thing. It's supposed to be the first thing. Amen?
Amen.
The heathen raged and the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. I'm the heathen ruling my kingdom. How did he melt my earth? How else is God going to melt an earth? Love and mercy. He uttered his voice. What do you think comes out of the voice of God? I hate you. I can't stand you. Get out of my sight. What gospel are we preaching? Come and pay for your penance and do your time. I can't find that in Scripture, church.
No.
I can't find, that's not grace speaking.
No.
That is not the grace of God. My Bible says that he delivered the new covenant. The new covenant is what? It's grace.
Amen.
Grace and truth.
Amen.
But it's grace.
Yes. Yes.
It's grace. What do you think he's speaking here? Can't we all sing about that?